Now that we've finished going over the CodeFlare stack and its benefits at a high level, let's dive a little deeper and demonstrate what you can actually do with the stack, as well as how to do it. First, we'll begin by popping into the RHODS dashboard and launching a CodeFlare Jupyter Notebook server. So we'll go through and select that. And now, once we're inside, you'll see that I've prepared a number of tutorial and example notebooks for us to walk through today. Now, let's begin with the basics in this first notebook, defining and launching a Ray resource cluster, examining cluster status and details, and taking the cluster down and freeing up those resources. The first thing we will do is authenticate with our desired user account, if the default notebook user isn't desired. Once authenticated, let's continue by defining our desired resource cluster using the cluster and cluster configuration objects. We can specify the desired CPU, GPU, memory, and number of workers we'll need for whatever dev worker jobs we have ahead. Once the cluster object is created, an app wrapper will be generated in the background, matching the requested resources. When we want to bring up this Ray resource cluster, we call cluster.up, and this submits the app wrapper to MCAD, our queuing system. If the resources in quota are available, MCAD will pass this request over to the KubeRay operator to bring up our resource cluster, and if not, it will remain pending on the queue. Now, looking at the cluster status, we can see it's pending, so we can call cluster.waitReady to wait for the Ray cluster to be ready to use. This is especially helpful if you want to just run all the notebook cells in sequence, as it will guarantee resource availability for the cells below. Since it looks like our cluster is ready, let's take a look at the status again. Looks like it's up and running, so let's make sure that the specs of the Ray cluster are as requested. Calling cluster.details, we can see we got exactly what we asked for, as well as some additional information that'll be useful for later. Let's imagine, however, that perhaps your OpenShift cluster doesn't have the resources you need readily available, or that you don't want to hold on to idle GPUs and resources and have to pay for what isn't being used. If dynamic scaling is what you're looking for, then look no further than InstaScale. Here, we'll have our cluster definition, but this time you'll see two interesting arguments: InstaScale equals true, and machine types being passed in. When we set InstaScale to true, we are enabling the InstaScale component of the CodeFlare stack for this resource request. Basically, once our request app wrapper is on the MCAD queue, instead of pending due to lack of resources, if the quota is available, MCAD will pass the request on to InstaScale. InstaScale will then scale up new machines and nodes with the requested resources. What types of machines will be scaled up? Well, that's where specifying machine types comes in. Note that this component will work in any OpenShift environment that supports machine set or machine pool configuration. So whether you're on a self-managed cluster or in the cloud with a managed or dedicated cluster, we've got you covered. Now, we can go through the same steps as before, and this time, after the Ray cluster is up and running, we will see that our details show what we'd expect, GPUs and all. There we go, with two workers, each with one GPU, as well as our 8 gigs of memory and our two CPUs, as requested in our cluster definition. Now, if we also look into the OpenShift console, you'll see those two GPU machines that InstaScale scaled up on our OpenShift cluster. And just to verify that they did just come up, if we take a look at our GPU resources in the OpenShift cluster, you'll see that at the time of scaling, they went from 0 to 2. Now, when we're all done with using our resource cluster, we can call a cluster.down. And this will take the Ray cluster down and clean everything up, but InstaScale will also ensure that the new scaled up resources are appropriately scaled back down, and that the OpenShift cluster once again returns to its original state. So, we've shown you how to request and secure resources, but how do you actually use them? Well, there's two main ways, submitting direct patch jobs and workloads, and developing interactively. Let's start with the interactive development case. For this example, let's try an interesting task: fine-tuning the DistilBERT large language model on the IMDb dataset. For that, we are once again going to use InstaScale when defining our cluster in order to scale some GPUs. And so we'll call our usual cluster.up and wait ready, and note that scaling up GPUs and provisioning machines from AWS will likely take a few minutes. So now we'll call cluster.details, make sure we got what we expected, and we've got our two GPU workers ready to go. Once our Ray cluster's up, you'll notice that we have the ability to view both the Ray cluster URI and dashboard URI via the SDK. After grabbing the cluster URI, we can connect directly to our Ray cluster via the Ray Python client by calling ray.init. Here we can also pass in any additional Python package requirements we may have for the work ahead. Now, once connected to the Ray cluster, the interactive development pattern can begin. We can write functions and code as we would normally, using stock standard PyTorch, Lightning, Hugging Face Transformer code, and all we do is simply add the ray.remote tag on top to indicate that we would like to execute these functions on our remote resource cluster. For example, we've written a training loop function for the DistilBERT fine-tuning. When it's time to try something out, rather than call the function directly, we'll wrap it in a ray.get, and that'll call our function remotely, executing it on our resource cluster. Here, we can see that the logs for our fine-tuning task have started up. Now that the training loop has kicked off, we can also confirm it's utilizing the resources we promised. Going into the console, we can see GPU utilization for both GPUs that we just scaled up have gone from 0 to max. And so for us, it took about 700 or so seconds, and we successfully fine-tuned our model through that training loop we had written above. Now, if we wanted to tweak our hyperparameters and run it again, or write a different function like an evaluation function or a visualization or anything we might want to do during our development pattern, we could do any of those by either altering this cell, writing a new cell, just as you would however you're developing locally. And all you have to do is slap on another ray.remote tag, and when you run that cell, you can run it on the remote resource cluster. So, at this point, we've almost got the basics of the CodeFlare stack usage down. All that remains is direct, fire and forget, distributed training job submission. And so, I would like to finish this demo with an even more interesting use case. In the last notebook, we are going to try submitting a job for fine-tuning GPT-2 on the Wikitext dataset. Now, when pulling up our Ray cluster this time, we'll go through similar steps. But this time, you'll notice something interesting. We'll call cluster.up, status will start as pending, but if we take a look at our MCAD queue, you'll see that we never scaled down the last request. And so what's happening in the background here is that the quota has actually been filled by the last request that we made. And that user was actually borrowing quota from this one. And so MCAD will be able to make some smart decisions here based on priority and decide to preempt the last cluster resource request in order to get the resources to this high priority job. And so we can call cluster.waitReady and wait for those resources to be available to the user. And in just a moment, they will be. Now the MCAD queue only has this current resource request running on it. So we can take a look at our details again, and you'll see we've grabbed those resources that we need for this last job. So once we have our cluster, we are going to directly submit a job to kick off our GPT fine-tuning. To do that, we'll start by defining some script arguments that we'll want to pass into our training script, and then we'll use a DDP job definition object. If you take a look here at our training script, we've got nothing special going on. This is a stock Hugging Face Transformers fine-tuning script directly from their example repo. This job submission requires no modifications necessary to any training code, whether it be written in PyTorch, Lightning, Hugging Face, you name it. If we look at that DDP job definition object, we're passing in that script, as well as a name for the job, the script arguments, and our Python package requirements. That's it. And once we call submit, we'll get a job object back. Now, using that job object, we can see both the status and logs of our job. So if we look at the status, currently pending, and if we give that just a second or so, it should switch to running. And so here you can see we can also see the logs. Now, we'll give this just a few seconds, and in real time, we'll wait a few, like 30 minutes or so. And so we've completed our fine-tuning, and if we take a look back in the OpenShift console, we can see that the resources that we requested for this job were fully utilized throughout the fine-tuning run. And so we have full GPU utilization for the duration of our run. Finally, we can call cluster.down when we're completed with our fire and forget training job, bring those resource cluster down, as well as all of the resources that had been scaled up, and your OpenShift cluster will return to the state that it began in. And so with that, we have now demonstrated a number of various ways to utilize the CodeFlare stack through the SDK, as well as multiple examples of large language model training and fine-tuning. You've learned to request and scale resources, develop interactively, and directly submit batch jobs to acquire resources, all in Python. Thank you.